Morning.
Good morning.
Always a pleasure to see you. Love to be back. Kind of a real privilege to be able to share the word. And so DJ called me and he said, you know, every once in a while you're going to be coming back. So he said, you need to come up with a new series. And so I did. It's a sermon series that I wanted to do for a long time, and it's kind of entitled What the Bible Says About, ... and then we'll tie on to some, we'll latch on to some issues and deal with some topics that really touch our lives every day. And this particular one is one that I'll tell you where it came from and why this was first in just a few minutes. But with that, let's begin by prayer. Father, we just want to commit this time to you. Lord, we want to see your name lifted up. Lord God, we just ask that in these moments that, Lord, we can leave whatever is burdening us down at the foot of your altar, Lord God. And Lord, just to be able to lift up your name and commit all things to you. This time, Father, we just pray that you have the freedom to work among us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I had read an article not too long ago, just a couple of weeks ago, and it was called 10 Unbiblical Activities Most Christians Continue to Do Anyway. Okay, I couldn't pass that up, so I had to read this one. But what got my attention was what number one was on the list. And it was worry. Worry and anxiety were the number one thing that Christians did that's unbiblical, and yet they do it. We all do it. I'm not going to exclude myself there. We all do it anyway. And the scriptures have a lot to say about it, but there was several years ago, a woman was having trouble trying to get to sleep at night because she feared burglars. One night, her husband heard a noise in the house, and so he went downstairs to investigate. When he got there, he did find a burglar. And he said, "Good evening." He said, "I'm pleased to meet you." He says, "Please come upstairs. My wife's been waiting to meet you for 10 years. That's the way we are, isn't it? I'll never forget a particular encounter I had. I was just the ripe old age of 18, and I had just moved out from Oklahoma to work with a pastor that I had known in Oklahoma, here to Southern California. And I remember on a Sunday morning, I'd only been here about no more than 2 weeks, and this middle-aged woman came up to me after the service and said, "Could you pray for me and my family?" And she went through and talked about her son, who she believed was called to the ministry, but he was rebelling against God at the time. "My daughter is going to marry a man who's not a believer." And just pray for my husband. He's experiencing some really tough times at work. And I mean, when she was walking towards me, I'm sitting there looking at her thinking, this woman is carrying the load of the world on her shoulders, right? And it broke my heart, quite frankly. I mean, it was very surprising to me, you know. And number one, that she was going to come to me and ask for prayer. But it was after the service, and she just needed someone to pray with. And worry and anxiety affects us in so many ways. It is potentially debilitating, and it can be devastating to our lives. And at the very root of most of our fears. One writer said, "The problem is this: it's easy to let our concerns become our cares, and our forethoughts to become our fear thoughts." So the first thing you probably have to do, and I hope that all of you picked up the notes and everything on your way in. You know me, I'm going to bury you in paper. But you know something, I like to have you walk away with something that's going to, it has a lot more material on But we have to define worry. And I thought it was interesting that the word itself means to divide or rip apart. It's a combination of two Greek words. And so to divide or rip apart, and then the mind. So it affects our emotions. It has this devastating effect on us because it usually involves some kind of future event. You know, we worry about what's going to happen in the future. And sometimes it's the result of past sins. And generally, though, it speaks about our divided mind over the future. And you know what the scriptures say about a divided mind? James 1:8 says, "A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways." Proverbs 12:25 says, "Anxiety in the heart of a man weighs it down." And it does weigh us down. It can weigh us down. So when we look at this, it divides our emotions. We can be very irrational during times of great anxiety in our life. Our convictions can, if we have divided convictions, then it can lead us very easily to compromise the things that we know are right and good. Our perceptions, ever jump to conclusions that are based on completely wrong assumptions just because we were worrying about some circumstances. It can affect our ability to make decisions. We can become very, very indecisive and not really knowing what to do, so we just become paralyzed. In our extremes, it can affect us physically with all kinds of things that I just won't even go into because too many of us have experienced all these things. But it'll keep us up at night. It'll disturb us. It'll cause us to experience just all kinds of calamities. So one of the questions we have to answer, quite frankly, is worry a sin? That's a question I personally don't like dealing with, because for the most part, absolutely it is. And Romans, when we look at the scriptures and talks about Romans 8:28 says, "All things work together for good." Philippians says, "I can do all things through Christ." You know, and God supplies all our needs. And He assures us, "I will never leave you or forsake you." And 1 Peter, he says, "Don't be anxious for anything. You know, cast your cares upon God because He cares for you." In those moments of worry, we don't feel like anybody cares for us sometimes. We feel like that we're going through whatever this issue is that's burdening us down and that we're trying to take responsibility for, perhaps, and just plain not being able to set it aside, and we don't think anybody's there. And so it can be tough. It forces us to deny the very nature of God, and that's where the problem is. Did you know that in the scriptures there are, I have another side project that I'm doing, but I've identified 614 names, titles, and descriptions for God in the Bible. Okay? And what's amazing about all those descriptions is that they came about as a result of God intervening in the lives of His people. Just a few of the names here. Considering the names of God, they're really expressions of God's intervention in the lives of His people. Provider, comforter, guide, shield, teacher, He is love. He is our refuge. We sang about that just a few moments ago. Wonderful Counselor. He's our help. You know, you go through on and on and on and on. And I literally have all of these 614 names. And all of them came about because God was intervening in the life of His people in some way or another. Isaiah says, with steadfast mind, you keep in perfect peace because... the steadfast mind you'll keep in perfect peace because He trusts in you. Daniel, of course, had a great deal to say about it in the Psalms. He says, "When my anxious thoughts multiply in me, your consolations delight my soul." Another place in Psalms, he says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts." That's a prayer of my heart way too often. It says, "For I confess my iniquity, for I am full of anxiety because of my sin." When we know we're not doing what God's told us to do, we will suffer anxiety in our life and worry. So David was really great about seeking God in times of anxiety. He recognized that sin was can be a cause of that anxiety. Jeremiah says, "Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose trust is the Lord. For he will be like a tree planted by water that extends its roots to a stream and will not fear when the heat comes, when its leaves will be green and it will not be anxious in a year of drought, nor cease to yield fruit." When we trust in God, we can receive truly that life-sustaining nourishment. We can be firmly rooted against all of the challenges of life. We can be fruitful and nourished during difficult times. Adversity spawns service and ministry to others. But if we're in the middle of worrying it, we become very paralyzed and disabled by those things that we're concerned about. And we can be at peace with God and with man. Jesus himself had a great deal to say about it, and I was tempted to use this as my text today, but I'm not going to. I've got another one that I'm going to be moving to in a moment. But Jesus himself, after talking about worry, talking about do not be anxious for your life, what you shall eat, what you shall drink, nor your body. And he talks about what amount of worry is going to change one bit, one cubit to your lifespan. In other words, you're not going to live any longer by worrying about it.
Amen.
God has a time. For Sandy's dad, it was Friday. You know? And there is a time. What about clothing? He talks about the lilies of the field. And in this great passage Matthew 6, he closes that passage. He says, "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things are going to be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious for tomorrow." He says, "For tomorrow will take care of itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." The futility of worry is amazing, and he's very clear in these passages about it. It typically is directed at things that we cannot change and have no control over. Mark Twain said once, "I have worried over a great many things in my life, but most of which never happened." Psychological Journal stated that it had done a survey, and it said the average person's anxiety is focused on 40% of things that never happened, 30% of things that happened in the past that can't be changed, 12% about criticism by others, usually untrue, 10% about our health, which just gets worse with the stress.
Amen.
So what does that mean? 8%? 8% is really the problems that we will have to face. And I've known these statistics for 40 years, and it all still amazes me. And I see it played out in my own life. The things I'll fret and worry about don't happen. And I'm sitting there going, "Oh, okay." And if they did happen, for the most part, couldn't change it. The promise of the Father is, he says, if you're committed to me, if God is our first priority, that we will be provided for in this life. He even had to say some things about the end times in relationship to worry, which is kind of interesting. Whenever you look at the state of the world, the state of everything else that's around us, and the things and the events that you have to read. I'll tell you what, I don't pay attention a lot to news. My wife gets up in the morning and turns the news on, okay? And I'm done with it. just done. But the bottom line is this, whatever he says. He says that be on guard, that your hearts may not be weighed down with dissipation, drunkenness, and the worries of life. I never put those things together until I noticed this in the scripture this week. So, and that day, talking about end times, will come upon you suddenly like a trap. So we can be distracted from really being able to recognize the hand of God and the timing of God and what He's doing. Paul had a great deal to say about it. He talks about a worried relationship to marriage and ministry and burdens of ministry, the burden of ministry. But one of the most interesting passages to me is in Philippians, the 4th chapter. If you have your Bible with you this morning, I'd appreciate you turning to that. Philippians, the 4th chapter. It's a set of verses that I have always been fascinated by, that I have worn out in my prayer life, that I have, I don't even know how many times I've gone through this and considered it. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses comprehension or all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there's any excellence and if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. Or literally what this is let your mind dwell on these things. Intentionally focus on them, in other words. And he says, the things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the peace of God will be continually with you, is literally what it says there. Now, most people stop after those first few verses, you know, and say, wow, God's gonna guard our hearts and minds. But that's why I add those last couple of verses, verses 8 and 9, for a reason. But I love it, the way he starts it. He says, be anxious for nothing. Now, I don't know about you, but when the scriptures tell me something that directly, I'm trying to figure out if there's any wiggle room to it. You know what I mean by that? Something I don't have to necessarily, maybe it's sort of, but, you know, it doesn't apply here or whatever. There is no wiggle room to that statement by Paul and earlier by Jesus. Do not be anxious for tomorrow. He says, there is no wiggle room. Paul clearly taught that anxiety is not to be a part of the believer's walk of faith. So let's talk about the practical steps. He follows that statement up, or that command, if you will, up with some clear steps of action. First one is seek after God. How? In prayer, in supplication, with thanksgiving, being able to worship and confess the things that are before you, and interceding on the life of someone else if you're worried for them. It's the first thing we should be doing, and I don't quite get it. I don't know about you, but whenever I start feeling overwhelmed and worried, where's the last place I go? Or finally, it has to get me to a place to where, okay, I'm going to go to God. Like, I should be going to God. What am I doing? What an idiot. You know? My wife likes to tell me I'm an idiot occasionally. And I feel like God's almost standing up there saying, idiot, just come to me. Bring it to me. Seek my face. Over and over again, I know that I'm in the company of a lot of idiots throughout history and Bible, because they would fail to seek God first. He says, cast your burden upon, this is the psalmist, cast your burden upon the Lord, and He will sustain you. He will never allow the righteous to be shaken. First Peter says, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, and He will exalt you at the proper time. casting all of your anxiety upon Him because He cares for you. You know what I love about that passage? Remember where Jesus told his disciples they were going to be fishers of men? Anybody here ever do any fishing? Okay? Yeah, I grew up with it. My grandfather was a bass master. Okay? And so every time I got with him, from the time I was angel's age, my grandfather used to take me out fishing. And but what he was teaching me was to do what? A lot of it had to do with casting. Casting. Looking at the signs on the water, and then you cast out there because the fish are over there. And that's what he's telling us to do. Not only fishers of men, but fishers that cast our cares, just like we do that bait out to under the water. It's casting on our Lord because He cares for us. Second thing He tells us is to receive the peace of God. And I love that, the way this is described here, because number one, it says that peace of God is beyond man's comprehension. I know that sometimes my wife and I talk about, you know, I'm glad that we didn't know the future of our lives and all the things that were going to happen, because that would be overwhelming. Okay? God gives grace for today. And the things that we experienced, we were at peace. But if I knew what was happening at the XYZ time in our lives, I don't know how peaceful I'd be about it. I'd be fretting all the way there. In a lot of occasions. But God offers that peace to us. And I love it. He uses this wonderful term that is actually a military term. I'm an Army brat. Okay? I'm confessing to you. And grew up and my dad was in the military. We served in a number of places in the world. And so I know what it looks like to have a perimeter being guarded by soldiers. And that's the picture that Paul is drawing here. When he says, the peace of God, okay, will guard your heart. What's our heart? It's our emotions, our feelings. And he says, and your mind, your will, your thinking, that divided thinking we were talking about a few minutes ago, he's going to guard around that and take away those instabilities that are the result of worry in our life. But he goes on from there, and that's the part that most people kind of stop there, and then can't figure out. I mean, quite frankly, whenever I first started kind of applying this to my life, I'd kind of go about the business of my day, and all of a sudden, I'd start thinking about whatever it was I was worrying about, and I'm right back in that black hole that I was in before. And I thought, man, I can't believe this is a battle. You know, I'd go back and pray, commit it to God. Prayer, thanksgiving, Lord, thank you for all you're doing. And then I, you know, and trying to raise myself out of that. Because I wasn't experiencing that peace. It wasn't ongoing. Then I ran across these few verses right after that. Paul didn't intend to stop at verse 7, but go on to verse 8. And focus our mind on those things that are true, honorable, pure, lovely. Focus our mind on those things of good report and worthy of praise. So there's another step in all of this. Now, you know why that's needed? Because what's our tendency? We tend to go meet up with one of our friends, and what do we start doing? We start rehashing the circumstances. We start, well, you know, I don't know what I'm going to do about this. And before we know it, we're back in that blindfold. No, that's not what Paul knew. That's not what we should do. But rather, we should focus our mind on things that are positive. Focus our mind on perhaps the needs of others around us. and ministering and serving others around us rather than falling back into that trap. And then, of course, working through to some biblical solutions. You know, if you're not sure what the Bible says about whatever the circumstances are that are fretting you, then ask someone. Find somebody that understands maybe a little more than you about the Scriptures. The last thing he says is act. You notice those last parts of that verse where it says to, on the things you have learned, okay, this instruction that you've received in Scripture, you've received the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart and life, and the things you have heard. In other words, the wise counsel of others around you. It's amazing to me, sometimes people will come to me, ask a question, I'll answer it, then they go out and do the opposite thing. And then worry, and then wonder why they're overcome by worry again and anxiety. I don't get it. But I do it the same way. And then seeing in me the things that, the testimony of others around us. I love gathering people that are experiencing a crisis in life, something that's really fretting and overwhelming. I like teaming them with someone that's already been through those things. Because they know that they can offer a comfort and offer support in these circumstances that we're not going to find otherwise. It's frustrating to me to be sharing with somebody and I just look at them and I have to admit, you know something, I don't understand what you're going through because I've never been there. But so-and-so over here has. Let's sit down and talk with them. Let them share how God touched their lives and dealt with them through these circumstances. And then what does it say? That little phrase, you might underline it if you want to, and because he says, and the peace of God will be, and actually literally, will be continually with you. We don't have to be, we can experience this ongoing experience of the peace of God if we'll do those things. Friends, I don't know what burdens you may have brought with you today. But God wants to meet you where you're at right now today and offer His grace to you in those circumstances. That woman that I was talking about a moment ago had the son that was rebelling, and she knew that he was called into the ministry. That was DJ's mom. I didn't know if she was going to become my mother-in-law at the time. But you know, I'll never, ever forget when she walked away and how burdened down she was. And I thought, she can't go through life carrying those like that. I literally, a week or so later, gave her some notes on the very things that I've just gone over. I've shown you. And we never talk about it again. But I can tell you that what I saw was a woman who went from someone who carried those burdens on her back and her shoulder to a woman who knew the secret of taking it to God and passing that burden on and being able to live not under the burden of the things that are taking place around her, rather be able to rejoice in God and knowing that He was going to meet all of those needs. When she passed away a year ago, one of the big surprises the family got was they found a stack of journals. No one in the family knew that she journaled. And look at my wife, she's making me cry. But in those journals were those rich prayers that she had for her grandson James, who's right over there, for her son, for all the members of the family, the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren. She no longer was going to worry about them, but rather she was journaling how she was lifting them up to God. It's a totally different attitude than I saw 48 years ago in her. So God can change us in this area of our life. He does not want us to go through life burdened down and weighed down by the circumstances around us, but rather to be able to commit those things to Him and see Him work in them. So I want to be available to you today in these moments as we close and as we sing together. But I want to pray for you. I want to pray that God will bring you to that place to where you can experience His peace. Let's pray. Father, I am so very grateful for the very clear teaching of your scriptures. And Lord, we are feeble men and women, Lord God, that just look at future and look at our future, look at our past, look at all those things that become anxiety-ridden many times. And Lord, we just want to, in these moments, be able to lift up to you, Father, the things that burden us. Lord, we want to cast those cares on you. And Lord God, we just pray because of your compassion for us, because of your love and mercy towards us, Lord, that you would deliver us as you see fit. And Lord, we will trust in you. We will just continue to trust in you. And Lord, we receive your peace in these matters. And Father, we are so very grateful for your Son. And Lord, the sacrifice that he made so that we can be in relationship with you. And Lord, it's in his name that we pray. Amen.